Good afternoon and a warm welcome to this academic ceremony. My name is Peter Mulgaard. I'm the Dean of Maastricht University School of Business and Economics, and it's my pleasure to act as prorector this afternoon, and that means taking you through the ceremony. And that's a ceremony with which Professor Dr. Tina Comes will inaugurate her professorship in decision making and digitalization at Maastricht University School of Business and Economics. We recruited Professor Comes for our youngest department called Data Analytics and Digitalization, although when it became known that she would be willing to move to Maastricht, several department heads saw her impressive CV and there was a real battle to get her. In the end, Professor Dr. Alexander Grigoriev prevailed, arguing that Professor Comes would fit well with a basis in DAD, Data Analytics and Digitalization, and that it was clear that she would be able to work across departments and also across faculties. And indeed, from day minus something, Tina already contributed to the establishment of one of our three SDG spearheads that aim to co-create knowledge and societal knowledge with societal stakeholders within the areas of sustainable development, digitalization, and globalization. And this particular spearhead is called Maastricht Observatory on Resilient, Responsible, and Sustainable Societies, Enterprise, and Economy. Although I tend to get that wrong. So MORS for short. The MORS spearhead rethinks societal institutions across resilience, sustainability, and responsibility. And resilience is the institution's ability to absorb and recover from shocks. Clearly, Tina Comes' work is centrally placed for understanding and impacting resilience. Her LinkedIn profile explains that she aims, and she aims at improving disaster resilience by combining insights from the field with research in the following domains: scenario-based decision support to manage complexity and uncertainty, risk management and vulnerability analysis to understand weaknesses and hotspots, near-time real decision support and analysis, supply chain risk management to design agile and flexible supply networks, information and communication technologies and systems, and last but not least, critical infrastructures and smart cities. Unquote. That's a lot. Tina Comes' inaugural lecture marks part of the launch a week for MORS. To me, it is evident that she is very squarely placed in MORS, and that with her interdisciplinary approach, she is, or will be, a core player in this transdisciplinary initiative. Let me highlight a few of Professor Comes' publications before I turn to the person, Tina. Professor Comes' most cited paper came out in 2015, so quite recently, while she was a professor at the University of Agde in Norway, entitled A Critical Review on Supply Chain Risk, Definition, Measure, and Modeling. It is joint work with Iris Heckman and Stefan Nickel. And it is amazingly topical. It takes risk management to supply chains. Clearly, we have seen many supply chains disrupted or clogged up very recently, and the paper shows how to handle such risks. First, it redefines the concept supply chain risk as, and I quote again, the potential loss for a supply chain in terms of its target values of efficiency and effectiveness evoked by uncertain developments of supply chain characteristics whose changes were caused by occurrence of triggering events, unquote. And then the article, out in Omega, proceeds to discuss how the supply chain risks can be quantified and identified, and she identifies research gaps for handling these risks. I bet that there are a number of firms out there experiencing supply chain disruptions who would have liked to have thought harder about that a couple of years ago. In another well-cited paper from Decision Support Systems 10 years ago, Professor Comes and co-authors Michael Heete, Nick Weinhardt, and Frank Schultmann analyze how support for decision-making can be structured in complex strategic decisions. They develop a new approach based on decision maps that can support decision-makers under fundamental uncertainty through the use of scenarios that may be evaluated using multi-criteria decision analysis techniques. By integrating decision makers' preferences and by basing scenario selection on systematic evaluation, the decision map approach facilitates robust decision making, something we have clearly seen the need for during, for example, the COVID-19 crisis. Let me just cover one more aspect of Professor Comer's academic profile. Together with 16 co-authors, she contributed to the 2016 World Risk Report, featuring an update of the World Risk Index, which calculates the vulnerability and exposure to natural hazards of over 170 countries and then ranks them based on their disaster risk. The World Risk Report analyzes the role of 2016, analyzes the role that infrastructure plays in shaping a country's disaster risk, something that Professor Comer has also analyzed in a separate article in ISCRAM, joint with Professor Dr. Bartel van der Waele, where the focus is on two critical infrastructures, that would be transportation and power supply. Let me turn to the person, Tina. You don't have to spend a lot of time with her to note that she does not come across as a risk lover. She is very thoughtful and has a very underplayed humor, which I really have come to appreciate. Sometimes you won't even notice that she takes a mickey out of you. But appearances may be deceptive. Members of her department describe her as entrepreneurial. And I quote again from your department members, picking and realizing ideas on the go, sometimes even crazy ideas that she manages to control, unquote. One testimony to that is the number of titles she carries on her CV. She is full professor at the Technical University of Delft, full professor here in Maastricht, director of 4TU Resilience Engineering, and member of the Norwegian Academy of Technological Sciences, to mention a few. Another testimony to Tina's business acumen is that our managing director at SBE, Pien Versteeg, once described her as a magnet for money. However, when it comes to her department, Professor Comer is very collegial, sharing her money and her success and her networks with co-workers. We very much look forward to the collaboration here at Maastricht University, and right now we look forward to the inaugural lecture of Professor Dr. Comer on a resilience agenda for the new normal. Dear Tina, the word is yours.
Dear Peter, Pro Rector, members of the Collège von Bestuur, dear colleagues, family, friends, everybody who is here in this beautiful room and following online. I'm honored to be here today because basically since I was a small girl, it was my dream to first either become a queen or a king, but then I decided that was not a good option because they tend to get potentially beheaded or so, as we saw in the last lecture. And then it was to become an academic. So I'm excited and very thrilled to be here and share this day with you, and also to walk you through this resilience agenda for the new normal. And of course, I'm also extremely happy and proud to accept this chair on decision making and digitalization, where you may ask yourself, decision making, digitalization, how do these two go together, actually? So I'm here to explain you why and how. But first, I called it a resilience agenda for the new normal. And of course, this has created the need. It's a virus. So COVID-19 has affected all our realities. And of course, it's great that we can be here again physically together in one room. But the news this morning said it's far from certain how that will continue. And while many describe COVID as a medical disaster, actually the medical side is the success story of this pandemic. Within a couple of weeks, we had genome sequencing. Not even a year after the virus was detected, we had vaccines that brought hope for a return back to normal for so many. Seeing friends again, traveling. But at the same time, COVID also amplified the many, many societal challenges we are facing today. It has increased inequality, as many disasters typically hit those most that are most vulnerable. Even in the Netherlands, it has brought about a degree of despair that we had riots in this country, which is probably not the most revolutionary in the world, or at least not known as such. And that shows us that we don't really know yet how we can bring together, for instance, the centralized governance mechanisms that we have together with localized approaches. Or we don't know which decisions should be made, at which level, and at what point in time, and maybe not even by whom. Whereas to the longer term repercussions, we are just beginning to understand them. Of course, many have predicted that COVID has an impact on the SDGs, on virtually all of them, actually. So we now see that an estimated 60 million people falls back into extreme poverty. That means for the first time in more than 20 years, we see an increase of that number. We also see, of course, a lack of education around the world. An estimated 1.6 billion children and youth could not attend school or were not provided education, and we don't even know yet what that will bring us. So, I would like to explore how we can live in this new normal and what we can do about pandemics, crises, and disasters like these. And of course, there I also take a look back into history. Because it's not the first time we are confronted with very challenging societal problems. So here you see on the top row, black and white mostly, pictures from the 1960s in the US, where we had fantastic progress in engineering, first man on the moon. At the same time, that was also the civil rights movement, some picture of that here, this side. So then people started to ask questions. How can it be that we are able to fly a man on the moon and we are not able to deal with these challenges? And is there anything in our engineering toolkit, in our approaches to data, to modeling, that we can use so that we also can get a grip on society, so that we can manage these challenges? And that is then where a couple of people got together, and it was actually in a seminar series where Horst Rittel and Melvin Weber got together first. And actually it took them 5 years to write up the paper. Sort of story of my life, no. But they were then defining these problems as wicked, explaining why we cannot just use what we know from designing rockets and translate it into societal problems. So with these wicked problems, they tried to draw attention to the complexities of modern societies. And unlike tame problems, they are much more difficult to plan for, and it's unclear how and if and when we can solve them. And strangely enough, today we see the same phenomena. We see billionaires flying up to space. But at the same time, and that is a Black Lives Matter protest picture in The Hague, we are again confronted, or still confronted, with these societal challenges. So has there nothing changed since the 60s, 1960s, I have to remind myself to say. Of course, there were tremendous advantages in data, digitalization, modeling. And Peter has already said it, so some of my early work on that was trying to confront this complexity and uncertainty. It looks a bit overwhelming, and I'm not the best visualizer and designer, as you can see here. But there are many techniques and tools to address these problems. So there was adaptive management, we also have since the 70s, adaptive policy making. Here, and that was one of my earliest big papers in collaboration with my colleagues from Karlsruhe still, where we looked at creating distributed and decentralized systems to leverage the power of the many to create scenarios to support decision making. So there the idea was to have mathematical tools to bring together people to jointly create a better knowledge base and these scenarios. So that were very normative methods for decision making, adaptive planning, and sort of still quite theoretical. So I worked on this for a couple of years, and then I started to go from there, that was already in emergency management, into the real thing. That is, so I started to explore the reality of decision making in disasters. And that's images of field research we did with a disaster resilience lab on Typhoon Haiyan. That shows you the sheer destruction, scale and magnitude of that. That's actually what is going on, what people are confronted with in disaster response. So in how far are the decisions that are made under these conditions, under tremendous time pressure, with extremely high stakes, but still lots of uncertainty, in how far can we model them by these mathematical computational tools? Of course, also there, I'm not the first one to ask these questions. So actually, two Nobel Prizes in economy went for related concepts. The first one is bounded rationality, Herbert Simon. Okay. So if you're choosing, here in this example, your which yogurt you want to take, you can, of course, do a very complicated calculation and try to optimize what you would like to go for. Or you can just satisfy and say, hey, yummy, this is my favorite. But of course, you can also ask yourself, is a decision in a disaster really like choosing a yogurt flavor? Probably not. And that's why I show here also Daniel Kahneman, who has looked as of the end of the 70s at decision making under risks. And for his seminal work on prospect theory, for instance, shows that we value losses very differently from gains. And all in all, humans are far from rational, that a lot of theory still postulates, but their choices are prone to a large number of biases. And of course, this has led to a sprawling literature on behavioral economics, on cognitive aspects of decision making, and especially these high risk, time pressured situations are very prone to these biases. So how now do we get the two together, the mathematical, computational, and the behavioral and cognitive? And why do we need to do that? So decisions under risk. And of course, besides the pandemic, this is probably the greatest risk we are all facing. Decisions under risks are of increasing importance. Climate change has, of course, is everywhere in the news. But it's also very hard to overestimate the impact it has on us. Over the past decade alone, the number of climate disasters that we are facing has risen from 500 to 700 per year. More than 50 million people were affected in 2020 by floods, droughts, storms. And then, of course, on top of that came the COVID pandemic, delivering a double blow. We are also, according to the State and Trends and Adaptation Report, currently facing the sixth global extinction event. There were five in the history of this planet, and we are all witnessing the sixth. Actually, we have created the sixth. And to address such problems, it's not just a wicked problem, but there comes then the notion of super wicked problems. And of course, how can we overcome them? So two central tenets are characteristic for these super wicked problems. Time is running out, and our responses to the problem discount the future irrationally, meaning we focus on what is here and now and ignore what is lying far ahead. And COVID, I think, is one of the perfect examples of this, where we create past dependencies, think that it is a small, short-term, local problem, but it turns out not to be. So one of the central tenets of my work is that decision makers need to make increasingly uncertain and very far-reaching decisions at an accelerating pace. And so this is the example of personal protective equipment in COVID, where we worked on in one of the European projects I'm currently engaged with colleagues in Helsinki. So we looked into these personal protective equipment, and this morning there was in the news that actually the US still has problems with buying old gloves. We were looking at what created this problem and which states were better prepared to handle that and why. So we created this system dynamics model to understand it a bit better. What happened is actually that national states decided to protect their own markets. So they started to issue export bans, close border, prevent transportation from happening with the idea, okay, then I keep all my PPE for myself. That's great. However, on the longer run, this turned into panic buy, price surges. The lack of standardization then further led to a decline in quality of these products. So not looking at what is going on in other countries or how these people or leaders, policymakers may react, and only focusing on the short term actually exacerbated the situation. And this is for PPE. When we look at a recent report from the Global Center on Adaptation, also called the New Normal, a world of multiple shocks, they stress that the pandemic and our focus on spending money on the epidemic recovery is actually eroding progress in climate resilience, leaving countries and communities more vulnerable to future shocks. And I will argue that we see this time pressure and the acceleration across the board. And I've worked, as Peter also said, a lot on disasters and crisis management. But we see this acceleration in time, not only anymore for when we are dealing with disasters, but we also see it in critical infrastructure planning, in climate adaptation, in the way we plan and think about our cities. So I think that by learning from, for instance, humanitarian cases and from disasters, we are able to apply and transfer these insights to longer lasting crisis and adaptation. But then I looked around, like, really, is there nothing on this? I found an interesting article by McKinsey. Decision making in uncertain times. The timeline for companies to react to the coronavirus has shrunk dramatically. Here are five principles that leaders can follow to make smart decisions quickly during the pandemic. Fantastic, they solved it. Take a breath. That's always good, of course, and can't be wrong, but probably not what we would need here. So, therefore, I argue that we need to build more resilience. And I understand resilience as the ability of systems to sustain their key function in response to chronic stresses and abrupt shocks. And there are two major drivers currently also in the policy discussion that frame resilience. So one, of course, is the COVID pandemic, where the EU is just putting 750 billion euros into a recovery and resilience program, also fostering green transitions, digital transformation, and so forth. But the second great aspect is, of course, climate change, where the World Bank has put out a report that says the net savings from investing in infrastructure resilience in low and middle income countries alone is $4.2 trillion. So there's a lot to gain. And my take is that the advance of the theories and methods in digitalization and decision making provide us now with a really unique opportunity to address these challenges. And I will go a little bit over the hows and what I think are important challenges here. First, methodology. And I've said it in the beginning, we really need to bring together the cognitive and the quantitative aspects here. Still, you know, this is not commonly done. This is an illustration of the quant-qual divide. So we don't have the theories, the methods, or the models that inform how humans do make decisions and how they should make them. It's sort of almost two separate fields. And we are also not considering in there the far-reaching roles of digitalization. So what can we do there and what has been done? This here is a picture from the iTrack project, which I had the pleasure to coordinate. It's a European project where we looked into how mobile technology can help humanitarian aid logistics in conflict situations. So that are the situations where convoys are confronted with stops, where the people who want to provide the aid are at risking their own lives. So we were looking at that. But to do so, we actually also turned the campus that was in Delft into a simulation exercise gaming center. So this is actually behind the library where we tried to test our technology. And this simulation gaming setting is very powerful because it conveys it allows you to experience almost the reality of a disaster, but it's still a very protected environment. And another aspect of our work is that we developed research methodologies to translate or start to translate the rich findings from the field, from research, for instance, in this case, in Nepal, into very quantitative models. And I really hope that there are more people that start to combine these fields and approaches. Then secondly, decision information feedbacks. Okay. Another difficult decision. So the question here is, how much would you be willing to invest in information or in data? Because it's also a situation we are daily confronted with. There's so much data, there's so much information out there that each and every one of us constantly make the decision, what do we want to read? What do we want to look at? What do we want to retain? And then think again about a policymaker, a decision maker, who has these high stakes, very prone to cognitive biases. How can we help this dilemma of choosing the right information? Accessing the right information and then making good decisions. So again, back to Haiyan. That was in 2013, if you remember that. And there were, of course, lots of information and fantastic data available already then. There were then new efforts of the standby task force who created maps from social media. There was satellite imagery that allowed you to analyze the damage of a disaster, in this case in Tacloban. However, we did field research there, and that showed that these things were basically not used. This is a picture from a coordination cell there. So these products were discarded as too complicated, too time-consuming. And what we observed was rather fragmentation. So people stayed in their local pockets, they checked with their peers, with their neighbors on what was going on, they trusted their networks instead of looking or trying to understand, investing the time to understand. And that, of course, invites rumors, but also hampers coordination and effective decision making. So there we see that fragmentation is really, really a key driver of this very localized sense making that then leads to different narratives. If we agree on what is going on there, then it's very different for Alexander or Peter to convince us that it's something else. And that makes longer-term coordination difficult. And as here is a quote from the field, which said, "In decision-making, you have to keep moving. You cannot sit still and reflect too long. By taking a decision, you are moving, and then you can adjust and learn." And of course, that's very much adaptive management principle, right? You start doing something, you get new information, you learn, and you make it better. So we wanted to test if that's actually what's going on. So we did some experiments on allocation decisions in pandemic, where we were then trying, that was actually before COVID had reached its peak. We did an experiment with 20 professional responders there on how they analyze data and how they use it then to make their decision. And that was also an experiment where we tried to test fragmentation. So they had to basically share their information to come to a good decision. But what we observed there is that actually there was, so we measured the activities that these different people were undertaking And what you could see there in the small blue box, that's actually the debiasing activities. So the time that people invested in really comparing the information that they jointly had and understanding where there were data gaps. There was very little of that. And then that biased information led to biased decision, that is maybe not so problematic still. But then, and that is the important point, they were unable to correct it. So even though they knew their decisions were based on biased data, they were subject to something that is called confirmation bias. So once they had formed their initial idea of what was going on and what had to be done, they just stuck with it, even though they were aware that the data was biased or wrong and misleading. And of course, this has quite a lot of implications for all the approaches to adaptive management and adaptive planning, because basically it is not as easy as is always postulated. And then you can still say, okay, but this is going on with a professional decision maker somewhere, you know, but surely we are better. We did, also in the COVID response, a survey on that in The Hague, where we were testing also this fragmentation, and we found similar fragmentation, both, of course, in the way that we are meeting other people, as well as in the way that we are perceiving information. 3, digitalization. So is that then hopefully a way out of all this misery of wrong and flawed decision making? So, and we know it's crucial to overcome this fragmentation. We have to get out of our pockets. And then digital technologies provide us with unprecedented means to do so. Has long been a vision, right? So one of our ideas was to help people, emergency coordinators, who work in environments like you see up there. So you see these poor people who have to monitor like 20 screens. You now just have one. And then we thought, okay, let's help them, and let's try to provide them with all the information combined, just on one screen. And then also let's make their life easier, because all this decentralization is so difficult, so let's just give a centralized coordinator to them. And then we thought we had a great idea for a paper. However, that paper was the paper that had probably the most hypothesis that could not ever be supported. Still published, though. because we actually found that the way that the cognitive load that it takes you to coordinate people also makes it difficult to process this very rich information environment. So what we actually found is that for the teams that worked in a decentralized setting, they worked well with the enriched information, but the poor coordinators who were then confronted with the task to coordinate everybody and deal with enriched information completely lost the situational awareness, that's called, or the overview of the situation. So what we see here is that the roles of individuals and the way information flows has a significant impact on the performance, much more than we actually expected. And then we said, hey, we need to understand this better, and also, most importantly, how these things scale. So that's where we then turned into agent-based models. So the aim is there to design systems that allow us to understand how information is shared between different actors and at different times. And this is research from the Comrades project. It was also a European project where we did work in Jakarta, in Indonesia. Jakarta, the fastest sinking city, looks largely like that. And we were there working in communities that are also frequently exposed to flooding. So how do these communities share information, and how does it support their decision making? We have started to put this into one of these agent-based models there, and also looked at the impact of different boundary spanners, that is called, so different forms of media, like social media versus traditional media, or announcements. And we basically see that in most cases, volatile situations really require extremely intense information sharing. So a high frequency of information sharing. But that, of course, means that the relevance and truthworthiness of the information can hardly be checked anymore. And there's a delicate balance between providing updates very, very quickly or verifying that what you are updating people about is actually true. And then, of course, the Heroes project I was already mentioning, The pandemic has also changed all our behavior. So what we built there is a model that aims to capture behavior, what people do, on a very, very local scale. So at the heart, in the middle, is what people do and how they interact with each other. So we have citizens that use infrastructure, go to locations, do activities, and then meet other citizens, and in this way, of course, potentially spread the virus. This is a very, very local model, meaning we take it at the level of a city to understand how our behavior influences the spread, but also what local policies can do to impact the spread of a pandemic. And here you see that model. This is The Hague. You're zooming in now, you see the central station, university building. There's currently a lot of people in there. And what is unique about this model is really the granularity of it, where you can see we did not only model buildings in there, but actually floor level or compartmentalized floors. And all the numbers you see there represent individuals. So this model has as many agents as there are people living in The Hague. Now we are zooming into the shopping street. And again, I will admit that my visualizations are not the greatest, but slowly people come in here. And what you can also see on the left side is that we have many different infrastructures that we also modeled. So where people, ranging from workplaces to universities, police, pharmacies, supermarkets. And of course, this allows us also to see the patterns of what people are actually doing, where they are and where they meet. And you can see quite granular. And this fine-grained model also allows us to understand how infections are spread and between which age groups. And of course, the next step, and a dream that I hope to realize soon, is combining the two. What we understand about how information is spread and what we understand about how people behave to these coupled models. Next, what I talked about in the beginning, these rapid strategic decisions. So now we know, okay, information influences behavior. We can try to understand how these behavioral patterns scale. How do we get that now into better strategic decisions? This is a cartoon that actually comes from climate change. To go for the simple but wrong or the complex but right answer. And of course, you know, we have a tendency already for climate change was indicated that this is difficult. All the more it is the case for disasters. But of course, we have now more data than ever before, especially for disasters. And we can do something with it, because of course there is a saying that each disaster is unique, but we can learn something from other things that happened elsewhere in the world. So we built there on different globally and publicly available data sets, ranging from satellite imagery, climate data, to financial and tracking data, this self-organizing map, it's a machine learning technique, and fused this data from different sources to understand which disasters were similar, but then also which decisions were successful, what you could learn from these disasters. And I think that's a very promising way ahead to leverage these data sets. However, you can only learn what has been done, right? Because on the rest, you don't have past data. Then we discussed how we can combine humanitarian response and sustainability. And that may be surprising because you say, hey, humanitarian is everything but sustainable, so what does it do there? But actually, what you may not know is that these humanitarian agencies have big warehouses, like this one. This is actually a collaboration that we did with the Red Cross that's in Panama, their America's hub. Where we, for instance, see that there is still a massive bullwhip effect, meaning they still have the capacity there to respond to an earthquake in Haiti. And you can do that for a couple of years, but of course it's very expensive. So while the focus always used to be on effectiveness, we there proposed to go from the paradigm of effectiveness to sustainable humanitarian supply chain management, and also developed the models and tools to support these solutions. In this case, it was a master planning approach. Finally, then back to urban and urban resilience. I'm sorry, it's not Denmark, it's Helsinki. But normally in the resilience literature, we assume that there is somewhere a shock, then your system performance drops, and then ideally you try to put it up again. And we studied by looking at the case of Helsinki, if that is actually the case, and in how far. And maybe you remember that in the 90s, Helsinki had a great financial crisis, actually Finland and Sweden. So we took that case, also because Helsinki has a very very nice open data sets, but also because it's of course Finland, a social welfare state, where you would assume that they recover quickly from such an economic crisis. But what we found is actually there are still, so this crisis split Helsinki in a west and an east part, roughly, with large differences. And we could still, and that was from 30 years later, 25, 30 years later, we could still track these differences. So we are very far from this, you know, relatively quick recovery curve, especially if it comes to inequality. And then the question is, how can we make this better? And of course, there, so once we understand that, you know, these differences persist, it is about how can we design instruments, infrastructures, or tools that help us to predict the consequences of our decisions now in the future. And this year is, for instance, a project that we are working on. I don't know if you recognize it. It's the MRA, the Metropole Region Amsterdam, where we are using land use modeling approaches to understand how different interventions influence the urban growth in Amsterdam, but also what that then means for both resilience, for instance, of the infrastructure system against sea level rise, but also for socioeconomic indicators. So here we are really working on making this link between the short term and the long term. Looking ahead from here, why is this so important, and why do I make such a big urgent point from this? Well, we all know that we need to transform our societies, that we need to transition. I think there's nobody anymore that doubts that. But when we then look into the literature on transformations, then very often what is propagated is that we need a moment of fragility, like a shock, brittleness. The old system is sort of failing, and then we have to innovate and jump to a more sustainable state. So this is what you see in the picture here. Of course, the best alternative is you are already in the sustainable pathway, but no, it's not the case. So that is what the transformation literature suggests. But if we then look into the crisis and disasters, which are the moments where we can basically turn the wheel around, then we are actually very bad in realizing that. So it was just an article in Nature which shows that exposure to natural hazards event, in this case, is unassociated with policy change, in this case for disaster risk reduction. We can hope that it's better for the pandemic, of course, but if we want to have a shot at this, then we really have to understand how we can leverage this moment of brittleness to actually introduce and make change happen. And of course, I can't do this alone. So resilience and this line of thinking requires big science, and it requires team science. And that's why I also was very happy to have my co-authors always on each slide, and the people I worked with in the respective projects. Because I'm really sure that we can only foster these resilient societies if we are committing ourselves to team science, if we are open to collaborating across disciplinary boundaries. And I also think that I learned a lot from whoever I collaborated with. And of course, you know, this is a moment to thank everybody who has been there in the past, the PhD students, postdocs, the colleagues in the different universities. Peter mentioned a couple of stations along the way. But now, of course, I'm here in Maastricht and very much look forward to working with all of you. And of course, this is my home department, and if Peter said it, Alexander won the battle. And I'm very happy he did. Because when I first arrived here in Maastricht and I had a round of interviews, everybody asked me now, what are you now? You're not fitting in our boxes. Are you quant or are you a qual? And then Alexander took actually the risk, and also, of course, Peter and the rector and the Collège van Bestuur to hire somebody like me who does not fit into boxes and actually doesn't like boxes. So I'm happy to have a home in that with the fantastic colleagues who are also sitting there a bit more in the back, yeah, to improve our understanding of digital technology and decision-making in organizations, in public sector, in companies. But, and this is important, who don't only want to do that, but who also have the knowledge and dedication to build these tools and to make it happen. And then, of course, we are also here in the Morse Week. I put the title here on the slide so that I can't go wrong. So Maastricht Observatory on Resilient, Responsible, and Sustainable Enterprise and Economy. That's at least what it says on the website. Maybe you should update your website as much as I should update my LinkedIn profile. So also there, I'm extremely happy because my research agenda is very closely connected to Mars, as you've seen. So very happy to also find a new home in this. And as before, now I've been thanking a lot of people that are also here in the room, a lot of co-workers, but also thanks to my family. And my brother is sitting here. My parents are watching from home. And this is where I grew up. I got a lot of questions today. Where do you actually come from? It's a small village along the Mosel. And of course, thanks to my parents. They can't be here today. But of course, they are with us online. And I'm very thankful that they provided me with a nest when I was small, but then also tolerated my need for freedom and gave me wings when I was older and wanted to explore the world, in which I'm quite an outlier. And to my brother, who is here, who always had to deal with a very contradictory elder sister, he clearly survived it. Somehow. Yeah, so thanks for being here and for helping me become who I am. And of course, the final note goes to these people. We actually still have a small word open on this one because somebody here forgot to mention me during his inaugural lecture. That's what you happen with academic couples. And his excuse was that I'm actually so much part of his mental universe that he forgot to mention me, where I always say, like, am I a table or like... So you're still on the slides and I still thank you. Yeah, that's you. It's also because, of course, you are the one that has more faith and confidence in me than I sometimes have in myself. And you manage to both ground me when I need it and say, shut that laptop down. But you also give me the confidence that I dare do the things that I do. And then to Arjen, who just rushed in here, but in his new costume. It was especially bored for the day. To Anka and to Berger. Of course, all this work is for you, because you are the future and you are what counts. So, thanks, ik heb gezegd.
Well, Tina, you are a hard act to follow here, and I won't say much because I was flabbergasted with your impressive tour de force of many different disciplines, I think. And I don't know, so I really don't know where to start and stop here, but I was so impressed with the way you discussed bounded rationality and rationality, and how we can work with information overload. That is, of course, a very central point right now to discuss. Where are we in, and how can we deal with that as decision makers? Let me just, on a side note, say that I feel vindicated when it comes to Morse, right? Because you had managed to have a slide up with Morse, and I can put it up again if you need, where you had two different titles of Morse on the same slide, right? So it has societies in there in the text, but not in the title. So I really love that, because I've been corrected so many times, and I've tried to get it right, and now I think it's, maybe it is just a versatile thing, and it doesn't really matter as long as you know what you're talking about. And you clearly did, Tina. That's so amazing. I think the fact that you say that you don't fit into a box is what makes you fit at the School of Business and Economics at Maastricht University in general. I think you really have the competences to reach out to so many different collaborators. I loved the team science slide that you had up there, and the fact that you mentioned your co-authors all the time. But I think you will be a very strong connector between different disciplines, different departments, and humans. And so, a bridge builder, and welcome to Maastricht University for that particular reason. Yeah, let me stop here. I could continue, because I'm so full of many things you said, and it was so inspiring that I think we should now get out of this room and get into the Refter and have a drink. And now we can even have one with alcohol in it, so we can relax. Well done, and thank you all. There you go. And maybe I should just say for the record that we are going to leave in the cottage first, and then the rest will follow, and we're going to the Refter, and you're all cordially invited for drinks and snacks.